It's your fault that we left the boy behind. Blame. I was wrong. I am sorry. Please forgive me. Forgiveness. These two themes, blame and forgiveness, can come to my mind as I read today's gospel celebrating the Feast of the Holy Family. The initial reaction in reading this gospel, where Jesus is lost for 3 days, that is that Joseph and Mary appear to be pretty poor parents. I suppose in today's society, we would have called the Department of Children's Services and Family Services to report on them. But no way. People always traveled in large prayers and caravans in those days because the thieves and robbers that were on the road, aunts and uncles, grandmas, friends, relatives, they all traveled basically as one large family. And Mary and Joseph thought that Jesus was with the other relatives that first day they were on the road with their extended family. But after one day on the road, Joseph and Mary discovered that Jesus was missing. At this point, they were already out on the road one day. So they had one day was lost already in trying to find Jesus, and they spent the second day returning to Jerusalem, and on the third day, of course, they found Jesus. But nothing is really mentioned in the gospel, but it's that second day on the road when they're returning back to Jerusalem that really intrigues me. I just wonder, the reason I'm intrigued is because can you imagine a hypothetical or make-believe conversation that may have gone on between Joseph and Mary on the way back that second day, with Joseph saying something like, "Mary, this is all your fault. I'm losing time away from my job in Nazareth, losing money in my carpenter shop. If you'd have been looking after the boy, as any good mother should, he would not have been lost." And Mary sweetly coming back saying, "Joseph, you were with Jesus before we left. You took him to the square to visit with your men, with your friends. It's your fault. Blame. Whose fault is it?" Well, that scenario probably did not happen, but it was just something that came into my mind. As many of you know, I am an ordained permanent deacon with a family, and I had a similar experience many years ago. Some years ago, when our oldest child was 15 years old, and my youngest was 3, and my wife and I decided to take a quick weekend vacation, It was a Saturday morning, and I had to stop at my office first just to clear up some business. And my office is located relatively nearby down at Lawrence Avenue and Cicero here on the north side of Chicago. It was a small office about the same size as Our Lady's Chapel, divided into 4 small offices. I parked right in front of the building on Lawrence Avenue, and the front door was no more than from here to the piano away from me. It was Saturday morning, of course, and nobody was there. So all the kids wanted to come into the office. And I said, "Oh, yeah, you can come in, kids. It'd be great." And my wife said, "No, I want them to stay in the car. There's no need for them to go into the office." And, of course, the kids said, "Oh, Dad, come on." I said, "Sure, let them come into the office." So they did, against my wife's wishes. Well, after about 10 minutes in that office, which turned into 20 minutes, every phone button got pushed in that office, every intercom got banged back and forth, adding machines, we didn't have computers in those days, and typewriters, everything, anything that mechanical got worked. Well, when I finished my work, which took about 20 minutes, I yelled out to the kids, "Everybody back into the car." And all 6 kids left the office, I thought. Well, I jumped in the front of my car. I actually had it in drive, and I happened to turn to the right towards my office, and there in the front window was our son, 3-year-old Patrick, with his nose right up against the window. His hands were panic-stricken. If he could have come through the window, he would, bawling like a baby. We had left him behind. Jumped out of the car, ran into the office, picked him up and hugged him and said, "We would never leave you, Patrick. We'd never leave you." And I don't think he heard me because he was crying so hard. Our 6'4" Patrick is with us today with his mother, incidentally, my little Patrick. But once we got back in the car, my wife very curtly told me that this would not have happened if the kids had stayed in the car, as she had suggested. And I probably said something stupid back, like, "Well, if you'd come into the office like I wanted you to, it wouldn't have happened either. It's your fault. No, it's your fault." So we started blaming each other back and forth for about 1 minute in the car, when we finally realized our crying child needed more help than our egos. And so we stopped trying to assign blame. Who was at fault? The blame game. We all play it at times. It has never been known to solve a single problem, but the blame game can create quite a few. The worst thing in the blame game is this wedge that it drives in a family, particularly you and your spouse. And but in reality, the blame game drives a wedge between every single one of us. And in reality, it occurs at work, with our employees, with our friends and relatives, best friends. The blame game is bad news. And the worst part of this is when this blame game occurs between parents and their grown children and they come separated. Man, that just tears me up when I hear of families that are estranged like that. Well, here is the whole theme and thrust of this homily. There are four phrases, each three letters long, that solve a lot of problems in the blame game. And the first three of these phrases are, "I was wrong," "I am sorry," "please forgive me." And the power of those three phrases to heal broken relationships is amazing. But sadly, it often goes unsaid. "I was wrong," "I am sorry," "please forgive me." If those three phrases are said honestly, there's an important fourth phrase that follows it up immediately. And it's the fourth phrase, "I love you." Admitting we are wrong and asking forgiveness is always very difficult. But it's also very difficult frequently, as many of us you know, to forgive somebody who's hurt us very badly. And that's the key messages of all Jesus' Gospels today. Forgiveness and love. Love and forgiveness. Forgiveness is the key to the door to love. We cannot love unless we can forgive. We cannot love unless we can forgive. And so even when we are the wronged party and it hurts us, and maybe we've been grievously wronged, we have to forget. And frequently, we have to forgive, and frequently forgiving is a lot more difficult than asking for forgiveness. So that, and also today, as we celebrate the Feast of the Holy Family, that second reading has some key lines too from St. Paul. "Forgive whatever grievances you have against one another. Forgive as the Lord has forgiven you. And over all of these virtues, put on love. Love binds the rest together and makes them perfect." So in closing, and summing up, there are actually five three-letter words that is great in a relationship. And I've already mentioned some, but we'll say it again. The first four was, "I was wrong," "I'm sorry," "I forgive you," "I love you." And the fifth one in a marriage particularly, which is very good, is, "Let's eat out."
Thank you for joining us for the celebration of the Mass today. It's a blessing that you are with us. Every broadcast of this liturgy goes out to hundreds of people and hundreds of people all over the world. It's been an enormous blessing. If you'd like to support this virtual ministry of OLPH, please go to our website. You can support this ministry by going to Give Central so that we can continue to broadcast the liturgy each and every week. Thank you for your support. Most of all, thank you for joining us today. God bless you. Greetings from OLPH.
You want them back?
If you
because I do have them.
Okay.
I mean, I should.
Okay. Sounds good. Thank you very much.
I'll see you next year. Yes, next year.
until next year.